The greatest prayer is to simply give permission to the Holy Spirit to speak to your mind. And once that happens, then you will experience what you call miracles. Give permission to the Holy Spirit to speak to your mind. This is rarely ever given, this permission. Rarely. Rarely, rarely, rarely. I only did it yesterday, actually. I realized that I had been trying to listen to the Holy Spirit and then me talking to the mind, as it were. The mind talking to itself. And I finally said, Holy Spirit, why don't you just talk to the mind? Because I had this dream wherein the idol, which we have made idols to intimidate and bully and deceive us. And so this idol came and spoke to my mind, and it was so effective in freaking out my mind. I said, wow, that's terrible. And I realized only the Holy Spirit can counter idols. Only the Holy Spirit can counter idols. In fact, God created the Holy Spirit to do just that, to counter the idols that we have made. The idols that we have made are incredibly clever and vicious and are fear-based. Their whole intent is to make us afraid of God. Their entire intent, and they're experts at it. And so I said, okay, Holy Spirit, I give you permission to speak to my mind, to speak directly, not through me, directly, speak directly to my mind. Because I know that you are not cowed by idols at all. And only you have the expertise how to calm the mind down. And so, in doing this, I became aware last night of just a huge amount of change in my position and policies and foundational reactions. It's just something is amazing. And so I don't even know how to, I don't know what the Holy Spirit said. It doesn't matter. It has the way to speak. It's somewhere that we're not aware exactly what the Holy Spirit is saying to the mind. But if we give it permission, that's the winner. That's the winning ticket. And yet, how many will do that? I don't know. Super rare. Super, super, super rare. Because we think, well, we made this problem, we can fix it. Of course, we made this problem to be unfixable. We're trying to make the problem unfixable. And it's like our own creativity is being used against itself, against itself. The mind is trying to destroy the mind. That's a very severe situation. Hypothetically, it is. So, short of dropping all hypotheticals, which we could do, but we're afraid of a continuity issue. So, because we're afraid of the continuity issue, we won't drop hypotheticals all like that. Therefore, we do have this seeming impasse. We're blocking ourselves. So only the Holy Spirit is able to speak to our mind in a way that can calm the mind down, and the mind can make fundamental, important decisions, foundational decisions, decisions about premises, about foundation. Now, the idols are attempting to divert us away from the Holy Spirit and get us to get help in any other way. So idols are giving us massive amounts of help in the world from all these different directions. All of that is an attempt to shunt us away from allowing the Holy Spirit to speak to our mind. That is the one thing that we fear, that the ego, the idols are absolutely opposed to. They'll make any bargain at all, to stay away from that. So I can just report that in allowing that to take place, I had just a bevy of dreams, just a whole constellation of them last night, where there's these fundamental decisions were being made in my dreams. I just like, wow, yeah, that's incredible. Never had anything quite like that. They're decisions at a deeper level. See, the functional self on the surface here is just a functionary type of thing. It's just a facade. The deeper down is where everything is happening in the mind. So dreams often reveal what is going on beneath the surface. So obviously something profound is going on beneath the surface of basic decisions, like 180 degree reversal, that kind of thing. How? Why? Because I must be because the Holy Spirit, I gave it permission and continue to give it permission to. And I don't know, I'm not aware of what it's saying or how it's saying it or anything. So I would say, even I got that from A Course in Miracles. Jesus said, allow the Holy Spirit to speak to your mind. And I heard that. I never read that before. I said, wow, that's the best advice I've ever heard. You might say that all spiritual teaching is just to get us to the point where then we decide, hey, Holy Spirit, you take over. You speak to my mind, not me, not my spiritual teaching, not my path, not any of that. Because guaranteed the situation is too clever by far for us. We're in over our heads because we're literally trying to destroy ourselves. We're trying to destroy ourselves. That's what existence is all about. That's the purpose. And so we're terrified of going back home because we believe that we have the power to destroy reality. And so reality is no longer a viable place. We have to learn to adjust to destructivity, to the power of destructivity, which of course is existence. Everything here is subject to destructivity. So we believe we have to make a home here in existence in hypothetical land. And that going back to reality would render us defenseless to destructivity. So we're literally, you know, extremely afraid of God, of reality, extraordinarily fearful of that. And no matter how much spiritual teaching we get, idols can easily speak to us and trigger that fear and throw us into all sorts of confusion. Like, oh my gosh, I better not go that way. It's too dangerous. It's too dangerous. So no matter what type of spiritual teaching path we've taken, idols still, we're putty in their hands. We're putty in their hands, actually. And that's what I've seen why people keep coming up short, is they take spiritual paths and the idols allow that to some extent. But at some point, the idol comes in and says, hey, you know, you can't go any further. That's what I experienced. It was amazing. I thought I had gone far enough where I was not subject to this type of influence. I know I was getting super close to liberation from delusion and the vision of timelessness. And what happens? This idol came in. It was in the form like of a goddess. And this idol spoke to my mind and totally freaked it out and brought in this intense fear and suffering by trying to convince it that going this way was the wrong way, and that somehow I was being deprived and misled, and all this horrible propaganda, and it caused a severe problem. And then in seeing that experience, I came to the conclusion, let the Holy Spirit deal with this situation. Let the Holy Spirit deal with idols, not me. Let me get out of the way. Let the Holy Spirit deal with idols. It's a funny thing that never occurred to me to do that before. I thought I was, but I wasn't. I was just trying to get information from the Holy Spirit so then I could deal with idols. That is the fundamental mistake that we make. We all make it. Our spiritual path, we're trying to get information to help us deal with idols instead of saying, hey, Holy Spirit, you deal with the idol. That's what God created you for. So let me just, I'll just get some popcorn. and enjoy what takes place. Because finally, idols have met their match, which is a wonderful thing because idols have tortured us for so long, all under the guise of helping us. The goddess idol is really a torturer, absolutely a torturer. And of course, it's all sugar-coated. It's all sugar-coated as if it's being done for our welfare. It's not. It's keeping us bound to fear. It's keeping us fearful of reality, fearful of God, enslaved to death. You know, all these relationships of the world, everything that people are doing, those are only relationships with death, which is really relationships with nothing, nothing whatsoever. And idols promote all this human potential, secular humanism, relationships, all this stuff that's promoted by idols. The only relationship we're looking for is a relationship with God, which is symbolized in symbols and hypotheticals as vision of timelessness, as a relationship with timelessness. That is the only relationship in hypotheticals that has any meaning, because it solves the continuity problem for us. And the Holy Spirit, that's its goal, vision of Christ, vision of timelessness, vision of oneness, the overlay. That is our goal. There's no other goal. Holy Spirit has that as his only goal. And so let it talk with idols. And of course, idols will say, oh, it's going to ruin all our relationships. Who wants relationships with death? Who really wants that? We don't. But the idols intimidate us. They frighten us terribly, and then they offer this relationship with death and say, oh, look, this is a good relationship with death. This will help you out. This will make you happy. This will make you progress. This will make you evolve. This is helping the planet, you know, advance. This is helping this, helping that. All this stuff, if it does not say, this is the vision of timelessness, the unconditional non-judgment of God upon all hypotheticals, upon everything, all symbols, all impermanence, equal non-judgment everywhere, vision of timelessness. Time is death. Time is death. Timelessness is salvation from death. It's timelessness solves the continuity problem with reality, really, is what it does. It resolves the continuity problem that we presume that we have. Pragmatic standpoint, we feel we have that. That's a legitimate concern, even though that it isn't a problem. But from our side of things, it is a legitimate boogeyman there, you know, to just suddenly realize that, completely forget everything that ever took place in existence, with bodies, with form, any of this stuff, as if it never was, because it never was. We feel that would be a continuity freak out. So that's why there's this God's plan of salvation provides this intermediate step for us, vision of timelessness. And then there's just this one timelessness touching everything equally. So your mind is relating to this timelessness because it reminds the mind of something very precious, completely precious, which is reality. Idols are truly vicious. Every time you make progress and you get closer to accepting the Holy Spirit to deal with idols, idols throw up some big dust up, you know, start screaming rape or something like that, which is a very common thing that the idols love to do, that to divert your attention away, you see, from letting the Holy Spirit deal with idols. I'll say, no, you have to, you understand suffering. Idols say that idols keep flattering you. Idols are great flatterers. They flatter you, saying you're the one that understands. You really understand suffering. You really know suffering. So, no, we don't. We don't understand it at all. Because the fact is, if we weren't frightened about the continuity issue, we would set all idols down like that. All of existence, we would set it down like it never was. We had no interest in it. We don't really have any interest in existence whatsoever. None. And there's nothing to understand about nothing. This is all just forms of nothing, and there's nothing to understand there. So we don't understand it. We do not understand it. But the Holy Spirit accepts the fact that we don't understand it, whereas idols don't. I also try to get us to understand it. So, until we give the Holy Spirit permission to speak directly to our mind, we're in over our heads. We're in over our heads for sure. And it'll feel like a titanic struggle, huge struggle. Because it's guilt, the guilt that the idols throw on you, you know, just awful. Everything, they have so many tricks. And the Holy Spirit doesn't speak to idols, it speaks to the mind. See, that's why idols doesn't like the Holy Spirit. So they want us to speak to idols. You see, they tell us that we have the capability to speak to idols, of course, because we made idols. But we're imagining them. We're hypothesizing, what if there were such a thing? But there isn't. Not really. So the Holy Spirit speaks to our mind and reassures it somehow. So our prayers can just simply be, Holy Spirit, I give you full permission to speak directly to my mind right now. Unfiltered, I don't care what you say. It's not my lookout as far as what you say. I trust you completely to speak to my mind. That's it. So that's the Uber boost. That is really the Uber boost. Even beyond the guru. It's even beyond the guru. The Holy Spirit's the real guru. So when you give the real guru full permission, speak directly to the mind without any conditions, then you have accepted the guru. That's better than any guru out in the world externally. It's better. The gurus out in the world just remind you to take this step. That's what their really aim is really for. They know that they themselves cannot do it. Only when the devotee says, okay, I'll give the Holy Spirit the grace of God, unfettered, to speak directly to my mind. Only then is the situation in the right hands, put on the right footing, on the right foundation. So the gurus, the real gurus, don't have ego in that way. They don't think that they are the ones who are going to help you. They're simply saying, hey, give permission to the Holy Spirit to speak to your mind, that's all. Those are the real gurus. And the real gurus are simply, when they're here, what are they seeing? Timelessness. That's all they're seeing. They're seeing timelessness. And by showcasing that, they reassure us like, hey, this is a goal I really want. It's there. It's possible. And all I need to do is let the Holy Spirit speak to my mind and to reassure it about this. That's how it is. It's really simpler than we realize. But idols throw up enormous roadblocks to this. It confuses us, having us run around in circles endlessly. They're just... See, we're doing everything we possibly can to avoid this. Everything we possibly can. Freaking ourselves out. It was the experience. What brought this about in me is that I experienced the full effect of idols talking to my mind. I was just observing this. There's an observer to this, and the lies and deceit and trickeration and twisting were so malevolent, so terrible, that it left a lasting impression. I said, "Wow, that is beyond vicious." All, of course, done with all this kind of sweet kindness, helpfulness, like a loving mother trying to set a wayward child straight. All done in the spirit of a loving mother, you see. But it was totally vicious. So we try and wrap idols in this velvet cloth. We dress them up beautifully, try to make them appealing to us, comforting, soothing, calming to us. Of course, we do that to the ultimate. We try so hard to make these vicious death-based idols seem welcome to us, so that we'll welcome them. Say, oh, please, idol, here, tell me what's true. Inform me. Give me guidance. So, of course, we're always wrapping them in the most beautiful packaging possible. And sugarcoating them and making them seem very as attractive as we can possibly make them. And yet they're bringing this awful, awful fear of God, fear of truth, fear of life, fear of eternity, eternal life. And demands that we die, that we remain loyal to death, to impermanence, to suffering, to torture, to misery, to depression, all this nervous breakdowns, confusion, that we remain loyal to that, that that's somehow the answer for us. I remember once I saw this idol that was this beautiful goddess, and I saw what the game was, and I saw her again, and she was this horrible, decaying, death-based, sick, hideous hag, you know, hideous. And she said, well, I'm glad you've seen me now, finally. You've seen through that. Again, these are just something we've invented, these idols. We've invented it as devices. We've imagined them, conjured them up out of our imagination to be our gods and goddesses, to guide us, to keep us bound to this realm of make-believe, realm of death, realm of murder and killing, and it's really suicide. Is all death is suicide, really. Realm of horrible, vicious sufferings and all this nightmare, this terrible nightmare. We imagine them, we're supporting them, and we are giving them trying to give them power over us. But they don't really have power over us. But hypothetically, they do. You see, they have hypothetical power over us. And since we are dwelling in hypotheticals and are afraid of reality, they hypothetically do have power over us, hypothetically speaking. Whereas the Holy Spirit knows that they don't have real power over us. And the Holy Spirit speaks to our mind and enlightens our mind on this fact. So the Holy Spirit is the real enlightener. It's the real enlightener. It enlightens our minds. And all we have to do is just get out of the way. Invite the Holy Spirit in. Take a seat and just sit back and eat the popcorn. Eat some popcorn and enjoy. Because we don't know how to free our minds from idols. We don't. But the idols tell us that we do. See, that is their trick. That is their trick. Idols tell us that surely we're smart enough to deal with it. Surely we must be smart enough to deal with it. And idols encourage us, come on, you can, you know, work harder, you can get it. And we think, well, okay, not true. Our minds can get it, but our minds need to be reminded perfectly of the truth by the Holy Spirit, by that which has zero fear of idols, that is not cowed in the slightest bit by any hypotheticals, not in the slightest bit. And only that is truly capable. And the rest of the time, we're just kind of spinning our wheels, which is true. I always wonder, why are we spinning our wheels? We're just spinning our wheels in the sand. Very strange. I just kept observing that. The spiritual path has to be one of honesty, where you recognize, hey, I'm spinning my wheels. How come I'm not succeeding? And just keep looking at that. Instead of saying, oh, yeah, I'm succeeding. What happens is people get together and they reinforce the notion that they're succeeding. It's kind of like a delusional club of delusion. Everyone says, yeah, you're so wonderful, you're so great, love you forever, and you're so wonderful, you're so great, you're so wonderful, we're all succeeding. But they're really just spinning their wheels. they're not being honest. And if someone tries to say, well, wait a minute, you know, I just feel like we're not getting anywhere, the group then, you know, attacks them and says, you're dragging us down. No, you're breaking the spell. But honesty is the best policy. And you just have to be honest and say, wow, I'm still spinning my wheels. I have not yet succeeded. This is not going anywhere. It's not going where I want. And just be aware of that and say, huh, okay, let me study some more. Let me see what the answer is. Well, I don't know what the answer is. And it's our pride that keeps us blinded. It's our pride that keeps us blinded. We think we should be able to resolve this. But the thing is, it is resolvable. It is resolvable. But it's God that resolves it, essentially. Because we try to say, well, God's will is not fixed. Reality is not permanent. Okay, that's what we are asserting. We are asserting that reality is not permanent. That's the assertion of spirit. Spirit's making that assertion, which gave rise to all this nonsense. So God just simply reaffirms that reality is permanent for us. And that's what we need to hear. Because how do we overcome our own assertion? How does spirit overcome its own assertion that reality is not permanent? Therefore, spirit itself is not permanent. Therefore, how can spirit, believing this, how can it affirm that it is permanent? You see, it is a dilemma. It's a dilemma. And idols keep reminding us that, oh, hey, you know, you're not permanent. How can you be permanent? Even God isn't permanent. You can't be permanent. You need to get used to impermanence. You need to be happy with impermanence. You need to learn how to relate with impermanence. And here's all these wonderful people to help you relate to impermanence. So you need to be engaged with that dance of impermanence and learn how to dance and be happy and joyful within impermanence and all this stuff. And you're cowed by that, and you say, wow, okay, I guess that's what I need to do. But for me, I always looked at the world and I said, no, it's this, everything that people are doing, that's not it. That is not it. No matter what they say, I can tell it's not it. They're not succeeding. They're not getting free. They're not really happy. What they're doing doesn't work. I just spent a lifetime of looking at stuff and say, well, I can see it doesn't work. It doesn't work. It's not going to work. Basically, you can say, I can say this, that everything the world is doing now is not going to work. That's a fact. It's not going to work. And of course, since the world is following idols, and you say, what you're saying is what the advice of idols, it doesn't work, it's futile. Idols are, you know, furious about that. But until we repent, meaning turn it over to the Holy Spirit, we continue upon this death march. No matter how we package it, it's a death march. That's it. It is nothing other than that. Doesn't matter how many high-sounding words are used, how glorious the future is painted, what kind of pictures we're painting of the future. None of that matters in the slightest bit. It is still a gruesome death march. That's all that it is. That's all that ever will be. And of course, idols are experts at helping us sugarcoat the future. But it's not nothing other than a gruesome death march until you turn it over to the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit has a capability. We don't have to understand how the Holy Spirit does it. We don't have to. It's not necessary. Because we're not the teachers anyway. It's the Holy Spirit that does it, so why do we need to know how it's done? We don't. We don't need to know. That's the great good news. That's the great good news. We have an advocate. We have a comforter. Jesus called the Holy Spirit the comforter. Why? It comforts the mind. Comforts the mind and gets the mind to accept vision of timelessness. The mind becomes willing to do that when it's with the Holy Spirit. Because the mind will choose the Holy Spirit over idols. The mind will do that. Because the mind will realize, this is what I really want, and this is truth. This is speaking truth to me, and idols are lying to me. Time is death. Time is a death march. Nothing more than that. Take away all the packaging and the sugar coating. It is a death march. Nothing more. Doesn't matter what kind of education you have, what kind of affiliations, how you live your life, all the things you do, none of that makes any difference. It's still a death march. It's just that along this death march, everybody tries to have bravado in some way. Everybody has their own ways of trying to, you know, make it seem like it's not so bad. Even though underneath they know that it is terrible. So the great good news, you don't have to be the teacher. You don't have to be the guru. The real gurus are the ones that know they're not the gurus. They're not gurus. They've gotten out of their own way. They let the Holy Spirit be the guru. And the peace of mind that they have comes from the Holy Spirit. It doesn't come from their actions. Our efforts. So the solution to our problems comes from God, you see. But we want it to come from us. And that's the problem. Because we believe God is impermanent. Therefore, any solution that God gives us is going to be impermanent also. So we think we're just a waste of time to accept this because we may enjoy the time vision of timelessness for a long time. But at some point, it's going to end because it's impermanent. And then what do? Then we're back. We've lost all that time to we could have been using to adjust to impermanence and try to make ourselves to sugarcoat death and try to be happy with it. We feel we've just wasted all that time and we're too far behind, and the idols just, you know, scare us to death with all this stuff. So we might just say, we don't know how the Holy Spirit does it. We don't know. We don't need to know. Idols want to know. Idols want to say, well, how'd you do that? I don't know. We don't have to know. Holy Spirit knows. That's good enough for me. But the idol says, yeah, but when the Holy Spirit's gone, what are you going to do? It's not going to be gone. It's not impermanent. See, idols are always speaking for impermanence. Always. That's their foundation. Impermanence. That's their premise. That's their basic premise, is impermanence. So because we're worried about continuity, we accept the final impermanence. The final hypothetical of a vision of timelessness, even that is impermanent. But it reminds us of reality. And so at some point we say, you know what? I want to set down all impermanence entirely, forever, all hypotheticals, which is really what impermanence is, just hypotheticals, because I know I got a good feel for what reality is like with this vision of timelessness. It gives me a very good feel for it, so there's no more continuity issue. So in hearing this, it's beneficial to hear it. Because I, like I said, I came across this in A Course in Miracles, Jesus saying, let the Holy Spirit speak to your mind. I said, wow, that's an interesting idea. Never thought of that. Never really thought of that. Like in that way, just it clicked. I said, that clicks. So sometimes you hear something, it'll click. You'll just say, ah, that's it. And we may think we have to help the Holy Spirit. Okay, we need to help you, Holy Spirit, because, you know, what if you're impermanent, or you may be impermanent, so you may be crippled or something. No, I think ultimately, step entirely out of the picture. Let the Holy Spirit be in charge of the mind. Because Spirit is in charge of the mind, and the Holy Spirit is merely a blessing upon Spirit. So it is still Spirit in charge of the mind. It's just not the mind in charge of the mind. See? And Spirit was trying to get mind to be in charge of Spirit, you see. So we have the right relationship between Spirit and mind has to be reaffirmed. It's Spirit that's in charge of mind. So the Holy Spirit comes in and convinces mind that it's Spirit that's in charge of mind, or convinces Spirit that it's Spirit that's in charge of mind, and then the fear, all this fear is dissolved somehow. But we don't need to know how. In hindsight, we might have clarity about how, but we don't need that, because we're not the teachers, so we don't need to pass that along. It's kind of like, I see the traditions now better in that there's less teaching. Less teaching is better teaching. We had to go through this phase. We've gone through this phase, and now we're exiting this phase. Went through a phase of a lot of teaching, tons of teaching, more and more teaching in the world, so many different teachings in the world. And we look at some of the great traditions and lineages of spiritual traditions, and we think, they're so impoverished. But not really, because at the heart of it is this humility and a trust and faith in the Holy Spirit, and that's all that's needed. So let the Holy Spirit speak directly to the mind. Don't need any teaching. So I've always said we're sophisticated savages here. We've gone through this information age, and it went to our heads like wine. And we are so drunk on this wine that we need to sober up now. And so there's been this process of sobering up that some have been trying to work on that. But working on that here is really sobering up. And the teaching is going more towards a minimalist type of situation, which is true humility, true repentance, true acceptance, true permission to the Holy Spirit, giving the Holy Spirit that permission. Whereas the Holy Spirit, we know it will deal with what needs to be dealt with in the right way. There's no question about it. Now, I have to say that I did get a glimpse a couple days ago during one of these tapings of how timelessness resolves this issue of death, and how it really is the correct way to perceive what's going on here in this world. I got a glimpse of it, so I know it's there. I said, that's it. I've always been wondering about that. How in the world, you know, Jesus says nothing, correctly perceived, nothing dies. There's no such thing as death. I said, wow, no such thing as suffering, all this stuff. How is that possible? I caught a glimpse. I saw that, but it's hard to explain. Very difficult to explain, really. It's the fact that moment is completely unlinked to every other moment. Each moment is complete and whole. In itself, and that we have to experience. You cannot grasp this in a sequential way. It all has to be grasped all together at once. One answer for all questions. So no more questions arise. It is the end to questions, because you see that the answer covers everything. It's completely covered. And we want to keep some loyalty to idols, so we reject this vision. Because once we see how it really is, there are no more questions. There are no more questions. And of course, idols love questions. So we say, well, what do we do with the idols? I mean, we need to question something. So we reject this vision. The mind says, wow, I don't know if I can accept this. You know, these idols are going to be. So at this point, let the Holy Spirit talk to the mind. It's beyond the common explanation. It's beyond that. At some point, you reach that point where you realize you just cannot go any further without bringing the Holy Spirit and saying, Holy Spirit, you explain it to the mind. I don't know how you do that, but you go ahead and do that, because I've seen it. I know you're right, but I don't know. You know, this cannot be gotten across by the methods of idols that we've been trained in, because our training in this hypothetical scenario of existence is from idols. We're giving ourselves this very, very, very crazy, whimsical training. And we're so super trained in that we simply, for the purpose of saving time, turn it over to the Holy Spirit. I mean, theoretically, we could soldier on for eons, you know, and would we ever get it? Maybe, maybe not, I don't know. But there's no necessity for that. We've so overtrained ourselves. This is something I've noticed in the world. One of the benefits of being here in this world now and looking at the situation is I've recognized the overtraining that we do. We do an astonishing overtraining ourselves to bow to idols. We are relentless in that. It's possible to just absolutely overtrain yourself, overlearn to an extraordinary extent, on top of all the other extraordinary overlearnings, to be loyal to idols. So with that in mind, in order to save time, turn it over to the Holy Spirit. Otherwise, the enmeshment in time would be so terrible. And the more we're enmeshed in time, the more we keep thinking that reality is not permanent, which makes us more loyal to idols. It's kind of like a vicious circle. Time is really a vicious circle. And the spiritual path, really, I'd have to say, is just recognizing how bad it really is. That's really what it's about. And when you finally see how really terrible it is, then you turn it over to the Holy Spirit. You say, wow. So, that's how I see it. I see the spiritual path as recognizing, honestly, just how unbelievably terrible and vicious this situation is, and how we have overlearned it to this abominable extent. And how cowed we are, and how frightened we are, and how unwilling we are, and how we're willing to waste time indefinitely on this trail of death. And in seeing that, the capacity to see that without panicking, without reacting too much, to just say, okay, I see that, all right. And then make the right decision, which is, Holy Spirit, it's all yours. You take care of existence. You take care of it. Turn it over. The traditional classical Christian thing is turn it over. Turn your life over to Jesus. It's really the Holy Spirit. Turn your life over to the Holy Spirit. Turn existence over to the Holy Spirit. Give the whole thing to here. Hand it over. So you take care of it. I see. But what you're talking about now, I see it. Yeah. It's really, the delusion is so severe. Again, in a personal anecdote, I woke up in 1978 and saw how severe the delusion was. I saw it. I saw the whole delusion. And at that point, I said, oh my gosh. And then I knew I was going to fall back under its spell. But I knew it was there. I knew this. But I saw how tricky and clever, and how severely we're under the spell of this delusion, how terrible it was. And then it's just a matter of the spell, of course, doesn't say that. The spell says, oh, no, you can learn spiritual path, blah, 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 blah. So that gets a grip of you, gets a hold of you, makes you think you can do it. It's a deception. And finally working through all that and finally recognizing, wow, nothing really works, and you're still spinning your wheels and you can't do it, then you say, ah, Holy Spirit, you do it. And then that's, I'm starting to, under the surface, experience some remarkable, miraculous changes of mind beneath the surface. Stuff that I've been working on forever, but I couldn't get the results. In one day of asking the Holy Spirit to speak to my mind, suddenly I'm getting all these results, incredible results. I said, my gosh, I've been working that my whole life. I couldn't get that. and not just one, but many, many, many. It's like, wow. And it's not that we're setting up the Holy Spirit to succeed. No, it's we're realizing we can't succeed. It's that we finally see, ah, it's too tough. It's too tough. No matter what we do, our overlearning and this vicious cycle of time, and our belief in impermanence, and all of that, simply leaves us unable to deal with the situation in a timely manner. At the very least, that is a fact. We're not able to deal with it in a timely manner. Which is why the world is in such terrible shape, and we keep thinking that we're going to succeed, but we never deal with it in a timely manner. That's something I've noticed in my life. I never, ever deal with situations in a truly timely manner. And I keep blaming the Holy Spirit, but I never gave the Holy Spirit permission to directly address my mind, the mind. I said, address me first, and then I'll address the mind. That kind of thing. That's not it. So, of course, there's a lack of timeliness. And in the world, you see that people are struggling. And this terrible oppression is coming upon the world. What it is in a nutshell, okay, it is disempowerment. Disempowerment is coming upon the world. And it is the most extreme disempowerment that's coming upon the world. And we all say, well, yeah, I know, but everything's going to be fine. At least that's bravado. But each step I'm noticing is we're failing to succeed in a timely manner. And this disempowerment just keeps coming on strong. And we just think, oh, God will step in and stop or something. Well, not unless we allow that to have Holy Spirit to step in. But it needs our permission. We have free will. It won't do it unless we give our permission. You see? And we're not giving our permission. That's the problem. And so we're failing to respond in a timely manner to this great disempowerment that's taking place. This global disempowerment. It's like going into a blackout. You know, electrical. Imagine if electrical grid, everything just blacked out, lost all power. You know, it's like that, but on a deeper level, it is a disempowerment. At least a hypothetical one. Of course, in hypothetical land, everything is hypothetical, but except the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit is not hypothetical. It's real. It's not in hypothetical lands, but it's capable of reinterpreting it, of dealing with it. It's capable of reassuring us. So, this disempowerment that is coming, good grief, don't try to deal with it from your own understanding. Let the Holy Spirit deal with it. So, the ultimate mantra is, the Holy Spirit, I give you full permission to address my mind, address my mind directly. I'm not telling you what to say or how to deal with anything, just address it directly. Not indirectly, directly. And I'll just stay out of the conversation. And I would say that this would bring true miracles. I can say really in my life, I've really not had any miracles, even though I've spent a whole lifetime dedicated to them. I can't say I've had any true miracles that really I feel like are significant. There's lots of little tiny ones, yes. Lots of little tiny ones, countless ones like that. But in terms of timely response to disempowerment, to the big picture, no, not yet. So I just admitted that. I say, hey, it's I'm still stuck, not safe, stuck in disempowerment. Everyone knows disempowerment's coming, and some are aligning with it, you know, like Quislings. Collaborators with it, thinking that they're going to have, if they align with the disempowerment effort, they're going to have the ones who have the power. And others are vigorously opposing it, realizing it's coming, and they're struggling against it. But it's like someone struggling in quicksand. The situation here, I'll tell you, is like quicksand. And I don't know if any of us have ever been in quicksand, but we've heard of it. And the fact is, the more you struggle, the more you sink. You have to be, if you're quick, very quiet and still, very still, and hope that help comes. that's pray for hope. That is true. So what I'm seeing is all the struggling against the disempowerment is only making it worse. It's only making it worse. That is a fact. That's something I see very clearly. The more Jesus says, don't love your enemy, don't oppose your adversary, you know. Agree with your adversary. Remain still. Remain quiet, remain still. Don't struggle. The great struggle, all these struggles, making it worse. It is incredible, the situation we're in. It's just, it's shocking, really. The more you see it, the more shocking it is. Because whatever anyone raises opposition, they end up crushing themselves. At a certain point, it's a death spiral of disempowerment. And again, the more struggle, the more you get sucked into it and pulled into it, and the more you get labeled as requiring disempowerment. It's better to stay still, better to stay quiet and still, humble. Say, you don't know the answer, but the Holy Spirit does. Let the Holy Spirit take care of it, and that's all. The real gurus, that they'll say they have nothing to say, really. No reason to say anything. It's the Holy Spirit knows exactly how to do everything. Let the grace of God provide the reassurance. And then, of course, showcasing this does help too. It's an assistant. You can render assistance in that way, but really only in that way. So these are advanced teachings, but the only teachings that really have full merit to them, which is necessary. This teaching is necessary at this time. It's always necessary with time. But this great disempowerment that's coming makes it imperative that we accept this. At some point, we'll realize, wow, we're in over our heads. We can't deal with this. It's not working. And we'll call help to try to see other people, you know, cling to them. And like crabs, everyone will be clinging to each other, but pulling each other down. You know, it's like that. Panicking. And many teachers will arise at this time, purporting to have the answer, the solution, and are purporting to be able to help, et cetera, et cetera. But that's not the case. at best they're incapable, and in many cases they're simply working for the idols. Where the idols say, "Hey, don't worry, look, you have these teachers now." You see? And you'll think, "Oh, okay. We can grab hold of those teachers, everything will be okay." Not true. Not true. At this time, it's the Holy Spirit, it's the grace of God that has to be turned to. Which is within. It's within you. So in other words, you have access to this. It's just as much as anyone else. All you have to do is give permission. Access is given through permission. You have to give permission. And again, the idols keep telling you, "No, you don't need that. That's just admitting that you're dumb." No, it's not. It's admitting that you're incredibly smart, because you're smart enough to deceive yourself so severely, you see. See, that is the thing, is we are so creative and so brilliantly intelligent and capable that we have been able to enmesh ourselves in this vast deception, this incredible deception, so tricky deception, and designed that we would never escape it, you see. So hypothetically, from the standpoint of hypotheticals, it seems like we cannot escape it. Again, if the continuity problem was not an issue, then we would easily set it down. But it is an issue for us. So because of that, from a practical standpoint, we're trapped. From a practical standpoint, we're trapped. Not from an absolute standpoint, but from a practical standpoint, we are trapped. So we do need the Holy Spirit to reassure us about reality and to speak directly to our minds. It is custom designed by the Prime Creator to do that. And we may ask, you know, "Well, what's it going to say?" I don't know. I don't know. I know its general principles. I know the basic gist of it all, but I don't know the artfulness of it, you see, of the approach, because it's unique to each aspect of spirit with the way its mind is configured in hypothetical land. Everything is unique and configured. All these defenses, everything is unique. So the Holy Spirit speaks to each one of us in a unique way. In a unique way. So there's no point in trying to explain how the Holy Spirit spoke to us, because that will not apply to you. It's completely artful. Total genius. The Holy Spirit is a perfect genius at this. And so you just let the perfect genius do its thing. I was astonished by the dreams last night. It's like practical progress, you know, practical stuff, like pragmatic, like, wow, amazing. And that's what we were lacking. That's what we're really lacking in this world. There's just an extreme lack of real, practical steps that will get us out of harm's way, as it were, of this disempowerment. This disempowerment is a trap that we have devised, that mind has devised for us, to keep us enslaved on the road of death. And we have devised it with extraordinary care and cunning and deception and intimidation and every last thing, as if there were no possibility to escape it. No possibility to escape it. And that's what we have descending upon us like a vast dust storm. And the seeing that and not panicking is important. So there is some help from these types of videos, because you can see that I'm not panicking, that I'm seeing it, but I'm not panicking. That's important. See, that is the spiritual path. It gets us to the point we can see how terrible it is without panicking, because we say, okay, I do have one option. I have an ace up my sleeve. Holy Spirit, time to play that ace. Time to play the ace. I'm not panicking, I'm not struggling. Those are the two things. So when you're in quicksand, as we are, we're all in quicksand, and you can see everything is getting sucked down. It's getting sucked down. And people are pretending that they're happy, like they're swimming in the quicksand. Like, hey, look at me, I'm swimming, I'm dancing with the quicksand. This is wonderful. All this stuff, everyone's saying how wonderful it all is. How we're going to this glorious destiny. As they're saying this, you look at them and they're sinking down lower and lower in the quicksand. And it's up to their necks, you know, and they're still chirping away, like saying, my God, this is like, I feel like I'm in such a great relationship now. I feel this is so wonderful. I feel everything is going to be so great. And, it, you know, it's just about ready to go over their mouths, the quicksand. And then their noses, you know, and that's it. So it's just incredible bravado in the world. Incredible bravado right now. We've trained ourselves. That's part of the whole deception, is to train ourselves in this bravado about how everything's getting so wonderful now. How could it be better? We're on the verge of this incredible new world. Yeah, world submerged, submergence in quicksand. Submergence and disempowerment. We've defined disempowerment as some transformation. Really, this great transformation that we're talking about, that's been, so many have been beating the drums for this great transformation, is nothing more or less than disempowerment, a severe disempowerment. And it's simply, it's like such a change. We're defining it like, well, it's a big change, therefore there must be some kind of new type of empowerment, because it's kind of Orwellian, like disempowerment is the new empowerment. That is literally, that's the mantra as we're sinking beneath the quicksand. That is the mantra that we have now, that disempowerment is the new empowerment. So that's the mantra the Holy Spirit can, only the Holy Spirit can deal with, because it's such a tricky mantra, isn't it? And the mind is like right now confused, it's saying, well, wait a minute, I can't quite resolve this clever mantra that disempowerment is the new empowerment, and it just can't quite, you know, say, wow, I can see it both ways. The mind is saying, I can see it both ways, I can't decide. Well, that's delay, and that's not a timely resolution to the situation. Saying, I can't decide. I feel so sorry for the mind, for myself. I said, hey, I'm going to let the Holy Spirit, you know, address the mind directly, because, wow, this is terrible. It took pity, you know, it's pitiful. The mind cannot decide which way to go, because everybody's singing this mantra in the world. Disempowerment is a new empowerment. And we're all going along with the Pied Piper of disempowerment, knowing that'll lead us into the new empowerment. That's the new definition of empowerment. It's disempowerment. Nobody having any power. See, nobody being better than anyone else, because nobody has any power. And the only ones that have power, we give seed power to them to make sure that all the rest of us remain powerless. And therefore, all one in disempowerment. It's the new utopia. You see, so this stuff is very confusing to the mind, because it makes plausible sense based, if reality were impermanent, then this does make sense to go towards this disempowerment. It's plausible. It seems like, well, this is hypothetically plausible. If reality is impermanent, then this seems to be the right way to go. But then we say, but yeah, but it doesn't work. we say, and then it gets very confusing. But we have all these like hesitations, saying, "Wow, you know, there's something wrong. It doesn't add up. It doesn't add up." So we're vacillating. We're confused. We're not sure. And this is like it's a roadblock. It's an impasse. It's a stalemate. It's basically a stalemate. So I recognize that I was stalemated. So you can recognize that. Recognize that you're stalemated, and then you say, "Okay, Holy Spirit, you come in and have the deciding vote on this. Let the Holy Spirit have the deciding vote, because I have one vote for and one vote against stalemate. Holy Spirit, you break the tie one way or the other. I'll accept whatever however you vote." And of course, I'll say, no, don't do that, because the Holy Spirit it doesn't realize that it's impermanent. God doesn't realize it's impermanent. And so they don't really know what they're doing. But again, let the Holy Spirit answer those questions, that type of stuff. So what we do here is we give the information out, and then we kind of little rest, kind of calm down, and then we give it out again, and then we give it out again, and again and again and again. It's necessary to repeat it. The idol says, "Okay, we got it. That's it." No. See, that's flattery. Look out for the flattery of idols. They'll say, you don't need to pay any more attention. You got it the first time. Now you know. You got it. Turn it over to the Holy Spirit. Okay, good. Got it. Next. What the idol will say is that it gets it. It'll say, "Oh, you explained it to me very well. I get it. Okay, I get it." We're not trying for the idols to get anything. We're asking for the Holy Spirit to speak directly to our mind. Speak directly to our mind, not to idols. We're not trying to convince idols of anything. See, idols will always vote nay, will always vote impermanence, always. They have no choice other than that, because they're nothing. So they're always going to vote for nothing. They're incapable of anything other than that. They're going to vote for remain with impermanence. That's the way, always. So it's useless to engage or speak with idols. Their vote is set. Even though they claim that you can change their vote, you cannot. You cannot. You cannot. But you can change the vote of the mind. The mind can decide which way to go. Or a spirit, really, that makes the choice. Then mind actually will go where spirit chooses to go. But we think it's mind that's doing the choosing, even though it's not. So it's really spirit is speaking, Holy Spirit speaking to spirit, but having to do it through the mind, as if it's addressing the mind, because again, spirit believes that mind is more powerful than spirit, that mind is the true creator and is higher than spirit. In other words, effects are higher than causes. So the Holy Spirit seems to be addressing the mind, but it's really addressing the spirit and saying, "Spirit, choose once again. Choose once again." So we keep reaffirming this. And us, you know, idols will hate this, of course. They're fuming mad. You know, they'll say, "Oh, it doesn't matter." The idols will say, "I got it the first time." No, we're not addressing idols. Idols never get it. They're incapable of getting it. And idols will say, "Well, test me out. No. It's a waste of time. Uh, the time for us is like those who've been on the spiritual path. It's like a orange tree, and we have an orange tree, several orange trees, and right now there are thousands of blossoms on it. So many blossoms, my God! And none of them haven't quite opened yet.